What if I tell you that the sum of the angle in a triangle is not 180 degrees? And did you know that Mount Everest is moving? It's shifting about 4 centimeters per year towards China. And it's a fact. When we draw an angle on a sheet of paper, the sum of the angles are confined to 180 degrees. But in practical, when we measure the large distance angles on the surface of the Earth, then the sum of the angle of that triangle is more than 180 degrees. This is spherical geometry. Due to tectonic plate movement, nothing is permanent at one place. Even Mount Everest is migrating to China. Good day, my friends. I'm Avijit, ex-Navy Surveyor with 37 years of experience and counting. I'm working in a leading offshore geodata company, and my job is to train the surveyors so that they can excel in each and every kind of offshore surveying job. If offshore surveying is your thing, then this is the right place you are in. Please subscribe and join my team as a member so that you can have exclusive access to all of my videos. So let's start today's discussion. Suppose you want to measure the distance between these two bottles. There are a few different ways you can do it. You can use a measuring tape and start measuring from one bottle to another. As you see, it's a little bit difficult to measure from one bottle to another by just one person. But if we are keeping the measuring tape on the ground, then it will be fairly easy for us to measure the distance between the two. We need a surface on which to measure. It is always easy to have a surface like a ground to measure something. And if you want to measure a large object like this car, you need a starting point to measure. For the length, we have to measure from this side. See, we are measuring it on the surface of the car. We can measure the length of the car this way, and we can measure the width of the car from this point. So, to measure anything, you need a starting point. So there are two things. Mainly, we need a surface on which to measure and a point, a origin point, from where to start the measurement. Let's say that we want to measure our height. For myself, how do I measure my height? I can say I can measure my height with reference to the ground on which I am standing, or even I can say that my height is from the sole of my feet. Now, can you tell me what will be the height of these mountains from where these mountains are being measured? Are they measured from the immediate ground or from what? So we need a particular surface from which to measure the height also. So we need a surface to measure the distance. We need a point, origin point, from where to start the measurement. And also we need a surface from which we can measure the height, right? So you see, the Earth's shape is highly irregular, with very high mountains to the deep ocean and flatlands. So how do we measure something on Earth? There is one way. We use a gravity model, or the differences in the gravity field, to create a model of the Earth, and we call this a geoid. We can say that geoid is a mathematical shape that the ocean water will take if there is no tide or wind under normal gravitational force. So geoid is an imaginary ocean surface which is wavy due to the gravity, and also it extends into the land. As gravity depends on the mass or the composition and density of the material on the Earth, it varies a lot from place to place. And that's why geoid has a very irregular shape. Now you know there are a lot of natural and unnatural activities, or the man-made activities that happens on the Earth, that redistributes the mass of the Earth from one place to another. For example, polar ice cap melting, or mining operation where they are taking out huge amount of earth from one place and dumping it into another place, or building of a huge dam where the water accumulates at one place. And that is only for the short time period. For a long time, the continent itself moves from one place to another. And that
creates a redistribution of the Earth's material. So you see, the gravity itself is changing over a short period of time and over a longer period of time. And so does our geoidal model. And this is the reason we need something more regular, more smooth and more permanent. And that's why we use a reference spheroid. Now, spheroid is a smooth and mathematical regular shape surface which encompasses the entire Earth. And this mathematical model is used to define any point on the surface of the Earth. And we also measure the height from this spheroid or the ellipsoid. Now, calling it a perfect sphere would not be correct. Now, this spheroid or the ellipsoid is compressed at the poles and bulging out at the middle. And that's why it is called an oblate spheroid. The very first global spheroid was defined by British geodesist Alexander Ross Clark in 1866. Much later, in 1980, we refined it and it came out as a GRS 1980. And later, we refined it much further and today we are using WGS 84. So how these global mathematical spheroidal models are defined? They are defined by two simple parameters, equatorial radius and polar radius. As per Clark 1866, GRS 80 and WGS 84, the equatorial radius is 6378 km and polar radius is 6356 km. They differ just a few hundred meters from each other. This ellipsoid is the basis point for our latitude, longitude and height. The origin of this spheroidal model is the center of the Earth and the height is measured from the surface that is encompassing the entire Earth. We call it ellipsoid. This Clark 1866 and WGS 84 and GRS 80, they are also known as ECEF or Earth-centric Earth fixed coordinate system. So what is the difference between a geoid and a spheroid? As geoid is based on the gravity, the geoidal surface is perpendicular to the gravitational pull of the Earth. What is a gravitational pull? You see this plumb bob? This line is always directing towards the center of the Earth and it is acting on the gravity, right? So as the gravity is different in different places, we have this plumb bob lines vary from one place to another place. So we have a very irregular shape of geoid, smooth but irregular. And as we discussed earlier, the gravity of the Earth is changing from place to place over a short period of time as well as over a longer period of time. So every now and then, we need to modify the Earth gravity model. Every 10 years or so, a new gravity model comes out replacing the older one. We have used EGM 1996 and then in 2008, a new improved model EGM 2008 came out. Now, EGM 2020 was due by April of 2020, but as of today, it's still not released. I guess we have modified the Earth gravity to such an extent that the scientists are unable to make a model of the gravity anymore or unable to keep up with the model of the gravity. If you are intrigued by the gravity model, then you can visit this website. I'll have the link in the description below. We still use Clark 1866 model today. Our understanding about our Earth has changed over the years due to the satellite technology. But rather than a few minor tweaks, the Clark 1866 remains same. So how is this possible? See, this is the simplified mathematical model. But today we are using the Earth movements and other gravity models to incorporate that into our today's spheroidal models. And we started calling it ITRF 2020. It's a short form for International Terrestrial Reference Frame. But there is a little problem. As we see from our gravity model, the Earth has a lot of bumps and holes. The smooth ellipsoidal model does not always everywhere aligns perfectly with the gravitational field. That means that the ellipsoidal model is not perfectly perpendicular to the gravitational pull of the Earth at every place. So why that is a problem? You see, the geoidal surface is perpendicular to the gravitational pull of the Earth, but the ellipsoidal surface may not always be perpendicular to the gravitational pull. So there are two verticals, that is the gravitational pull verticals, which is aiming directly to the center of the Earth. If there are differences between these two verticals, then there is a problem. In a model world, we want these two verticals to align perfectly. But this isn't a model world, right? So at some of the places, there is a difference in angle between these two verticals. And that is called deflection of the verticals. The bigger the deflection of the verticals, the bigger the angle between these two verticals, the bigger the measurement error they are going to be. So this is why we need a separate datum that matches almost perfectly with the geoidal model. We'll discuss about datum in our upcoming videos. But first, we need to learn how we can draw our 3D Earth on a 2D piece of paper. But that will be the video for another day. Meantime, remember to ask questions and always be curious.